himself. And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation unto himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Here endeth the epistle. At that time, Jesus said unto the multitudes of the Jews, My flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers did eat manna, and are dead. He that eateth this bread shall live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. In June of 1509, there was one thing exactly the similar to this year. Easter Day was extremely late, almost as late as it could be. That meant, of course, inevitably, that Corpus Christi was almost as late as it could possibly be, in very late June. It was the law in England that in the period between Corpus Christi and Midsummer Day, the Feast of the Nativity of St. John the Baptist, the 24th of June, there was a period of festivity as pronounced as that between Christmas and Epiphany in those days, which seems now to have overtaken Advent in our secular time. When Easter was very, very late, the crown could decide that the period of festivity was too short and extend it arbitrarily. In 1509, for example, the so-called month of festivities would be exactly 8 days this year until next Friday. In 1509, the new sovereign, Henry, eighth of the name, decreed exactly that. And so it was that the festival period began on Ascension Day and carried on until Midsummer Day. To coincide with the new reign and the end of court mourning for Henry VII, there were riotous celebrations. What was different in 1509 from this year was how the people celebrated and why. During the period of festivity, on which Corpus Christi was the zenith, communities of guilds, fraternities, parishes, and city officials gathered together across the kingdom to put on grand displays of community spirit. In London, Corpus Christi watches could involve processions of over 2,000, with archers, gunners, choristers, and guildsmen, all in elaborate attire, lined up according to precedence. Alongside them paraded Morris dancers, a plaster of Paris giant, and a float with St. George, and a fire-breathing dragon that thrilled the children. It was a traditional day to put aside old enmities and grudges, and rejoice in friendship, gathering together around bonfires in towns and villages throughout the kingdom. It was also the day that Henry VIII had chosen for himself and his queen, Catherine of Aragon, the Spanish princess, daughter of Ferdinand and Isabella, to celebrate their coronation. Far to the north, in the kingdom's second city, York, there too, in their livery, all the guilds and senior officials, led by the Lord Mayor, stood in rank. Crosses glinted in procession, and through the mist of the incense of many thurifers appeared the crowning glory of the day and of the season, the monstrance displaying through a glass window the body of Christ, always known by its Latin name, Corpus Christi. Early in the morning, guild members and the great and the good would assemble at All Saints Church, North Street, on the edge of the city walls, wearing their livery coats and bearing torches in the early light. They could not be at Westminster for the coronation, but they could celebrate it in their own city. After the early mass at All Saints, a richly bejeweled monstrance in a lavishly wrought golden shrine, studded with gems, was brought out on a great litter and carried by 12 chosen men to represent the apostles. In a gesture to authenticity, one would always quit the route partway through, leaving the other 11 to carry on without him. Everyone in the city, literally, turned out to join their friends and acquaintances who were in the procession to watch it. Bells pealed from every church and from York Minster. Priests sang, the streets were strewn with flowers, and the sun rose over the spires of the city as the body of Christ was paraded with the royal color guard by the Archbishop through the very narrow medieval streets of the city of York to York Minster. Those narrow medieval streets are still there, and because many sold animals, whether alive or dead, they were called, and to this day still are called, the shambles. The streets are just as narrow and just as winding. If you squint your eyes and ignore the mobile phone shops, the Pizza Express, the Marks and Spencer, you can always almost imagine the medieval shops doing lively commerce also. And All Saints North Street is still there, exactly as it was, with the same religion it had then, having restored it all in the 19th century. And York Minster is still there, the building, as it was then, with some changes from fire and tempest. A Dutchman, a painter, Frederick Fries, and his wife Joanna were in York whilst he completed some commissions. Whilst their own native land was not without such spectacles, and certainly Bruges in the Spanish Netherlands had a spectacular example of them on Ascension Day, which survives to this day. They were astounded at the richness, the splendor, and above all, the universality and the camaraderie of the events of the day. Frederick Fries, our Dutchman painter, after the procession ended at York Minster, and benediction was given in front of the great cathedral, and then inside, for what was essentially the entire city, asked a Franciscan friar about the events of the day, and what people thought of them, and why they did it. The Franciscan friar seemed confused and rather surprised. He said, "We worship the body of Christ because we are the body of Christ." In retrospect, this spectacle is bittersweet, is it not? That same young king, full of promise, devotion, and learning, who was to be with his queen, a frequent pilgrim to the shrine at Walsingham, by the end of the reign had ended it with lust, fraud, lies, greed, heresy, megalomania, and destruction, beyond what anyone could possibly have envisioned. And he himself had destroyed the shrine and kept its riches for himself. The religion of England since St. Alban was martyred in Hertfordshire in 251, when the Romans still held sway, and the English were all Celts, which was reestablished when St. Augustine landed in Kent with his 40 brethren in 597 under the protection of Queen Bertha, herself already a Christian, and converted King Ethelbert, later his kingdom of Anglo-Saxons. The religion which nourished them and prepared them to live life as best as they could and to face the next world as best as they could. The religion which bridged the Norman conquest, the Wars of the Roses, and the Black Death, was undermined by the king in 13 years and destroyed by his son and his henchmen in 6 years. After a brief return under Queen Mary, it then went underground again, and England was never the same. Its society was never the same, and that religion was never again at the heart of the kingdom. By the middle 18th century, the English writer Joseph Addison went to Italy for the grand tour of its art and architecture and antiquities, as so many young aristocrats did. And he wrote that Italy is the sink of iniquity, and that he came across the Corpus Christi procession, exactly like the one we have just been talking about in York, some 250 years later. And he regards it as, quote, "a ridiculous exercise of mummery, superstition, and overwarm Italian temperament, which, thank God, we do not suffer from in our more civilized land." But who was better off, the sneerer or the sneered at? The answer of the Franciscan was exactly right. Every single one of them received Holy Communion, probably not as often as we do today, but far more often than most of our friends and neighbors. They were united in one faith and purpose in their land, and felt a deep bond which transcended age, sex, social class, and politics, and was rooted in the Catholic faith. The adoration they gave the Blessed Sacrament at Corpus Christi was entirely religious, but also riotous fun. There were processions, plays, feastings, lots of drink, and even lords of misrule, as appeared at Christmas, who would have led people on some rather shocking adventures which were socially acceptable just for those few days, when everything was overturned. The fabric of their society could sustain all this because they had a very real sense of the truth, that the body of Christ, Corpus Christi, was two things: the actual physical body of Christ, which they received in Holy Communion, but also the body of Christ on earth, the community of those baptized into his body, who then became his brothers and sisters. Because they were brothers and sisters in Christ, even though separated by age, by sex, by social class, by education, or by wealth, they had this common bond, and they knew further that in the next life, none of that would matter. They also knew that the wheel of fortune, so often depicted at these celebrations, could turn, and those exalted, as our Lord said, could suddenly be brought low, and those abased could suddenly be raised high. They knew, too, that once they shuffled off this mortal coil, at a time they knew not, that each would go to his or her maker, naked and with no secrets before God. Shakespeare has all the men gathered at Agincourt the night before the battle in 1415 echo the same sentiment. Whether Yorkist or Lancastrian, winners or losers, adherents of the victor, Henry V, or those who lost either their cause or their lives that day, English and French. He says of them, "Those of us who meet God this morrow go in grim equality." Such is the case on a much smaller scale tonight. The faith that once joined a kingdom no longer does, and no longer even joins countries nominally entirely Catholic. Even the pockets of Catholicism in our city, in the ethnic neighborhoods, once brought together by these festivals, now struggle to keep them alive. But has their power declined? It has not. It cannot. For the same God who sat with his disciples broke bread and distributed it as his own body, which would give them strength the next day. The same God who rose from the dead and was known to them in the breaking of the bread at Emmaus, the same God who left behind the mass of the priesthood until he comes again. That same God leaves the tabernacle where he dwells, lonely and imprisoned for love of us, where he endures the indifference, the insult, and the profanation of many, just to be with us who appreciate him and worship him and bow the knee. Today, he bursts forth from the tabernacle and he walks among you as once he walked among the hosts of Palestine. We see his face as they did. He reaches out to heal us as he did them. He works miracles among us as he did among them. We require faith to see him, unlike as of old when all could see him. But otherwise it is the same. To the closed of mind, to the ignorant, to those whose hearts are hardened, or who have not yet come to the faith or returned to it, it is a ridiculous spectacle and it makes no sense. There have always been those who thought this. To them, no explanation is possible. It is simply nonsense. But to those who see with the eyes of faith, those who know what his healing touch can mean, know what his word can do, know how he can feed, how he can strengthen, and how he can, finally, raise all of us from the dead, as once he was raised from the dead. To us, no explanation is necessary. We know what he said, "This is my body." It admits of no question. We know that his apostles recognized him at Emmaus in the breaking of the same bread, and we know what it has done for us. We know what we see. We need no convincing, and we know that as he walks among us again, our response can only be one of joy, and it is therefore necessarily one of a community of the faithful. Those comparatively few of us tonight, kneeling for the procession and adoring his body, knowing that we see our God as closely as we ever will in this life, know that we are in a long line that goes back to that other late Corpus Christi on this same day in 1509. Yes, the queen they crowned that day will have her life and her dreams crushed. And yes, the king they crowned that day will try to destroy everything that mattered in their lives just to achieve his aims of greed and lust. But he has failed in his task, for we enter upon the same act of worship and praise tonight as did our forebears, whether spiritual forebears or actual forebears, or both, did on this day in 1509. Jesus comes among us literally. We sing, priests wear vestments and carry jeweled monstrances. There is song everywhere. Incense fills the air, and the world makes sense again, even if just for a short time. For the glass which is in the monstrance does not show us bread. There is no bread there. It shows us eternity and our God himself.
Thank you.
Most merciful Father, we humbly pray thee, through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, and we ask that thou accept and bless these gifts, these presents, these holy and unspoiled sacrifices. We offer them unto thee first for thy holy Catholic Church, that thou vouchsafe to keep it in peace, to guard, unite, and govern it throughout the whole world with all the faithful guardians of the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids, and all who here around us stand, whose faith is known unto thee, and their steadfastness manifest, on whose behalf we offer unto thee, or who themselves offer unto thee the sacrifice of praise, for themselves and for all who are theirs, for the redemption of their souls, for the hope of their salvation and safety, and who offer their prayers unto thee, the eternal God, the living and the true. United in one communion, we venerate the memory first of the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, the Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, as also of thy blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Thaddeus, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and of all thy saints. Grant that by their merits and prayers we may in all things be defended with the help of thy protection, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. We beseech thee then, O Lord, graciously to accept this oblation from us thy servants, and from thy whole family. Order thou our days in thy peace, and bid us to be delivered from eternal damnation, and to be numbered in the fold of thine elect, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Vouchsafe, O God, we beseech thee in all things, to make this oblation blessed, approved, and accepted, a perfect and worthy offering, that it may become for us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who the day before he suffered took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes lifted up to heaven, unto thee, God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to thee, he blessed, brake, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat ye all of this, for this is my body. Likewise, after supper, taking also this goodly chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to thee, he blessed and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and drink ye all of it, for this is the chalice of my blood, of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith, which shall be shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. As oft as ye shall do these things, ye shall do them in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Lord, we thy servants and thy holy people also, remembering the blessed passion of the same Christ thy Son, our Lord, as also his resurrection from the dead and his glorious ascension into heaven, do offer unto thine excellent majesty of thine own gifts and bounty, the pure victim, the holy victim, the immaculate victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Vouchsafe to look upon them with a merciful and pleasant countenance, and to accept them, even as thou didst vouchsafe to accept the gifts of thy servant Abel the righteous, and the sacrifice of our patriarch Abraham, and the holy sacrifice, the immaculate victim, which thy high priest Melchizedek offered unto thee. We humbly beseech thee, Almighty God, command these offerings to be brought by the hands of thy holy angel to thine altar on high, in sight of thy divine majesty, that all we who at this partaking of the altar shall receive the most sacred body and blood of thy Son may be fulfilled with all heavenly benediction and grace through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us sealed with the seal of faith, and who sleep the sleep of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant the abode of refreshing, of light, and of peace, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. To us sinners also, thy servants, who hope in the multitude of thy mercies, vouchsafe to grant some part in fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, with John, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee admit us, not weighing our merit, but granting us forgiveness through Christ our Lord, through whom, O Lord, thou dost ever create all these good things, dost sanctify, quicken, bless, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, the Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory are thine. Throughout all ages, world without end. Commanded by saving precepts and taught by divine institution, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
Our whose name we hold.
precious body and blood in this life doth foreshadow the everlasting fruition of thy Godhead, so thou wouldst vouchsafe unto us to be fulfilled with the same, who livest and reignest with the Father in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Thank you.
Yes.